Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. IRC report documents devastating impact of decade-long conflict on Syrian health facilities. US imposes sanctions against two Houthi leaders claiming Iranian support. ALBA TCP Political Council demands end to coercive US imposed sanctions. Demands for justice continue 5 years after the assassination of Berta Cáceres. A new report by the International Rescue Committee has documented the widespread destruction of Syria's healthcare facilities during the decade-long conflict. The report, titled A Decade of Destruction, was published on March 3rd in collaboration with Syrian partner organizations. It is based on surveys of 237 Syrian civilians and 74 health workers in the Aleppo and Idlib governorates. Almost 60% of the civilians interviewed had been directly impacted by an attack. Almost a quarter had been unable to receive medical treatment or had to flee their homes. 81% of healthcare workers surveyed stated that they had a co-worker or patient get injured or killed in an attack. The attacks have also caused psychological suffering and have prevented people from accessing medical care due to fear. The World Health Organization has estimated that 70% of Syria's healthcare workforce has fled the country. Physicians for Human Rights has documented 595 attacks on 350 health facilities across Syria over the past 10 years. The IRC report has also pointed to shortages in essential supplies and medicines and import restrictions on key equipment. The impact of chronic shortages and attacks has worsened under the COVID-19 pandemic. The IRC has called for broader humanitarian access as well as investments in the repair and restoration of healthcare facilities. The United States has imposed sanctions against two commanders of Yemen's Houthi rebel group. The Office of Foreign Assets Control under the Department of Treasury announced the decision on March 2nd. Mansour Al-Sadi and Ahmed Ali Hassan Al-Hamzi have been sanctioned under Executive Order 13611. The order aims at blocking property of persons, quote, threatening the peace, security or stability of Yemen. The statement released by the US further accuses the leaders of prolonging the conflict and worsening the humanitarian crisis. Mansour Al-Sadi is the chief of staff of the Houthi naval forces. He has been accused of smuggling Iranian weapons into Yemen and receiving training from Iranian forces. Saudi Arabia and the US have also blamed the Houthis for attacks on shipping vessels in the Red Sea. Houthi Air Force Commander Ahmad Ali Hassan Al-Hamzi has been accused of carrying out targeted UAV strikes and smuggling in Iranian weapons. The US has accused both leaders of orchestrating attacks to, quote, advance the Iranian regime's destabilizing agenda. Iran has consistently refuted these allegations, calling them a cover for the war crimes being committed in Yemen. As part of the sanctions, all US property and majority-owned entities connected to the two leaders will be blocked. All transactions, including funds, goods and services, will also be blocked. While the US has revoked the terrorist designation imposed on the Houthis, individual sanctions continue to remain in place. Three Houthi leaders, including two military officials, have been placed on the Department of Treasury's specially designated nationals list. The Bolivarian Alliance for the Peoples of Our America People's Trade Treaty, or the ALBA TCP, has called for an end to all coercive US sanctions. Foreign ministers from all member states attended the 21st meeting of the ALBA TCP Political Council on March 1st. They reiterated that sanctions had prevented governments in Venezuela and Nicaragua to respond to the COVID pandemic. This follows a recent report by UN Special Rapporteur Alina Duhan documenting the devastating impact of sanctions in Venezuela. Duhan stated that the unilateral sanctions imposed by the US, the EU and others constituted violations of international law. She also noted that restrictions on crucial food imports had led to a steady increase in malnourishment over the past 6 years. The US embargo on Venezuelan oil exports has also crushed the economy and restricted policy implementation. ALBA TCP has condemned the designation of Cuba as a state sponsor of terrorism by the United States. It has also called for an end to US-imposed economic and commercial blockades. As reported by Brazil, the FATO, the Cuban government, has estimated a loss of over $114 billion under US-imposed blockades since the 1960s. The alliance has also affirmed its commitments to ensuring equitable access to COVID-19 vaccines. Cuba and Venezuela have also agreed to the creation of an ALBA TCP vaccine bank. This includes supplies of doses as well as transport support. For our final story, we go to Honduras, which marked the 5th anniversary of the assassination of Berta Cáceres on March 2nd. Cáceres was an indigenous activist who led various struggles against imperialism and capitalism. She was assassinated by armed intruders inside her home in La Esperanza in 2016. Now, an ex-military officer accused of being the intellectual author of the murder is set to go on trial next month. Here is a video feature on the activism of Berta Cáceres and the fight to bring her justice.
5 years have passed since Berta Cáceres was assassinated in her home in La Esperanza, Honduras. Berta was the co-founder of the Civic Council of Popular and Indigenous Organizations of Honduras, COPIN. She was an indigenous revolutionary engaged in the defense of rights of indigenous people and of the land. She played a key role in the movement against the dictatorship after the 2009 coup. She faced a series of threats and physical violence throughout her activism. This was primarily because she led struggles in the defense of land and water and against capitalism and imperialism. Before her assassination, Berta had faced a campaign of constant harassment and threats from Honduran security forces as well as private security guards of the Desarrollos Energéticos S.A. company, DESA. She had played a key role in the resistance to the construction of the hydroelectric project Agua Zarca on the Gualcarque River, undertaken by DESA. In these 5 years since her assassination, COPIN has waged a tireless struggle to achieve justice for Berta. After a long legal battle, in November 2018, 7 people were convicted for participating in the murder of Berta. COPIN believes that the mere conviction of those involved in the murder isn't enough. For them, justice involves bringing those to trial who were involved in the planning and the financing of the operation. They point out that the powerful Atala Zabla family, who held positions on the board of DESA, is responsible for Berta's death. David Castillo, former military intelligence officer and president of DESA, was arrested when he was trying to flee the country for the United States in 2018. Records show Castillo coordinating with members of the Atala Zabla family about Berta and maneuvers to thwart COPIN's determined resistance to the hydroelectric project. The trial of David Castillo has finally been scheduled for April 6th to 30th. As COPIN and Berta's family mark 5 years since her murder, they have invited people from across the world to join them in their reiterated demands for justice. An international social media campaign is being organized to demand a just investigation and to ensure that David Castillo's trial proceeds without any delay. COPIN is determined to continue its struggle in defense of the environment and human rights, as well as justice for Berta.
That's all we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website, peoplesdispatch.org. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.